guys, welcome to the stream. Sorry it took a little bit longer to get everything set up. The servers were down for maintenance, but everything is back up. We have everybody here, everything situated, we're good to go. I'm going to change some of my volume levels here, but we want to go ahead and introduce everybody and talk about what it is that we're talking about today and all that kind of good stuff. So obviously right off the bat, we have the privilege to speak with a Blizzard developer by the name of John Yang. So he is here, and we're everybody make sure you're very welcoming.
Hey everyone, this is John here.
Welcoming.
This is his really crazy looking demon hunter right here. Look at that. Marauders. Man, you want to throw me a couple pieces of gear, man? and then also we have from RTG, we have Sibco, so welcome.
What up, guys? Hey, thanks, Shinobi.
And then finally, we have Flux from, I believe, Ink Gamers.
Hey, what's up, guys? I'm playing the Barbarian here, standing around in town.
All right.
Which is ironic, given that I often drink the tears of unhappy Barbarian players over recent nerfs.
Already.
And we were instructed not to ask if Blizzard hates characters, so I won't ask if you hate the Barbarian. That would certainly be a good topic to touch on. You know, the whole obviously there's been a lot of nerfs and changes lately.
I'm happy to talk about the nerfs.
Don't hold back, Flux.
So yeah. I actually had a question. I talked to Wyatt Chang like a year and a half ago, and asked him, you know, you guys have spent the last 8 months buffing all the other four classes in every patch. Would have been easier just to nerf the Barbarian, you know, right after release and achieve class balance that way. And that never happened. And now we've gotten it. Did you decide to wait until the expansion for that?
Yeah, I think for expansion time, we're much more at liberty to nerf the classes as we see fit. You know, things like Thrive on Chaos and Infinite Archon, there were problems before, and there are problems now. But for expansion, we're much more free to nerf them.
Mm-hmm. That was actually going to be the first question that I had to ask you, and we're actually at normal difficulty now, so we're going to switch that up in a second. But the first question I was going to ask you, because you are, you know, the Barbarian guy, the Demon Hunter Barbarian guy, is that you guys nerfed the viability of the Whirlwind spec from Diablo III, which was by far the best solo farming class in the game, spec at the time as well. And my question is, what kind of reasons did you have with nerfing that? And I understand the Thrive on Chaos lasting forever, like you just said, was an issue. But getting rid of the Thrive on Chaos to last forever, and then maybe because we don't have Lifesteal now, wouldn't you think that would have been enough? Why did you have to take it a step further and get rid of Into the Fray and such things like that? I felt like the Barbarian was a very optimal class, and I feel like most classes needed to be bumped up rather than the Barbarian being bumped down. So what do you think about that?
Sure. So Thrive on Chaos was nerfed, Into the Fray was nerfed, the proc coefficients on Run Like the Wind was also nerfed. Mm-hmm. The problem with those three things is every class, let's start off by saying every class is better off when their abilities are relatively evenly balanced with each other. So if I give you 10 resource spenders for your class and one is much better than the others, you're not going to use the other 9. It's like I gave you one. I think we can agree on that. Mm-hmm. That said, the amount of power that something like Into the Fray was giving was just way more than intended. You know, if I gave you a passive that says 100 fury every second, I would say that's overpowered. If I gave you a passive that says 3 fury per second, that's actually balance, and that's the number actually that we're tuning for, 3 fury per second for a passive on the mm-hmm. Barbarian. Into the Fray, it was just giving you too much fury. The permanent Whirlwind spec, it's fun, it's cool. Totally don't disagree, but allowing you to do that with just Into the Fray and you know, a mediocre amount of crit was just a little too much. And I know other designers have said, you know, near infinite resource wouldn't be a problem if it took you a lot of work and a lot of gear to obtain it. But I would consider getting 40% crit and putting Into the Fray on your bars not very hard. So. That's why it was nerfed. And now in the expansion land, you can probably still end up with specs that generate a lot more fury than the class is designed for. but you're gonna have to find some legendaries. You're gonna have to get your, you know, items up to a certain level of power before you can get it.
Yeah, I do feel like the the resource management, the fury generation for the regeneration for the barbarian is kind of lacking right now. But there are things like overpower with, I can't remember the passive, but if for every enemy that you hit, you get a bunch of fury. And if you're like surrounded by a lot of them, you get a lot of fury. Do you feel like that's what was more intended, that amount of fury, or is that even too overpowered? No pun intended.
Is overpowered. So, going back to what I said about passives, generating you 3 fury per second, and that being the point we balance for, that's the point that we balance for because we value, 1 point of fury to equal 20% weapon damage. And that's just mathematically how we tuned skills. You know, a skill that spends 30 fury, it would deal 30 times 20, 600 weapon damage, plus some other stuff. You know, minus some if it's AoE, etc. But overpower, that rune, it generates, I think right now, 5 per enemy hit, and it's on a 12-second cooldown reduced, like crits, etc. So it comes out to be something like an 8-second cooldown. 8-second cooldown, hit 3 dudes, 24 fury, divided by 5, it's like 5 fury per second. That's, you know, in the ballpark. The live number is 12. And that was just way too much. And it's another one of those things where we want to keep all skills and runes at an even power level so that if I want to use Seismic Slam or Rend or Hammer or what have you, it's because I like the skill or it's good for my build or my gear or the difficulty I'm playing on, not because it is simply way better than everything else that's comparable.
I've actually been doing my barb lately with fury, this current build, and I'm using the passive that gives you a bonus 25% damage, I think, if you have max fury.
Oh,
so I'm basically just doing that with overpower as kind of my AoE thing, and overpower really cools down fast with critical hits now.
Yeah, that's one of those things. You know, we have a lot of skills in the game that are tuned around crit. You know, on crit do this, on crit gain that. You get X critical damage, more critical hit damage. And those are all tuned around a certain point. The point we tune for is 40% crit chance, 400% crit hit damage, and about 1.5 attack speed. So something like overpower, it's cool because when your gear is bad and you don't have good crit, it's probably not so good. But once your gear is good enough, it becomes better and better. And I think that's a cool thing. There should be skills that work like that, and we have a lot.
Yeah, and I'm at like 2.3 APS too, so.
Yeah, that's really high.
But it's fun though. That's the whole thing. I'm doing fury with 2 weapons, so it's fun to zoom, 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 chop, chop,
yeah,
chop.
Yeah, it totally is. People get power with attack speed.
What I found with the barb was, and this comes from somebody that played, you know, hardcore Whirlwind Sprint Bard on the previous, you know, live.
You mean literally
was,
hardcore
that...
or figuratively hardcore?
Figuratively.
Like you played a lot.
Like I played a lot, you know.
Because that's different.
I wasn't watching TV at the time, but yeah. You know, what I found was that I went into the Friends and Family and Reaper Souls and I said, great, no more barb, I'm quitting that character. You know, that Nephilim is gone. But then what I found recently is that whereas barbs tend to be a hero that had kind of a one-button wonder, they wanted to focus on doing just one thing really well, I found that the new version of the barb, if you kind of pick skills for specific situations, you know, combine them all together, it produces some pretty fun outcomes. So I've had success in using like the whirlwind with the fire, the molten whirlwind, and then combining that with maybe a rend or overpower, combining that, you know, just combining like 3 or 4 skills that you ordinarily wouldn't think of. That's been a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's funny you say combining skills that you ordinarily wouldn't think of. And I think in the vanilla live world, you wouldn't normally think of it because 3 of your skills as a barb are Thrive on Chaos, Into the Fray, and Run Like the Wind.
Exactly.
And you really get to choose 3 skills at that point. But the game's designed for 6, and 6 is more fun. You have to think more. So it's better overall.
And one of the things about, I guess, the itemization change and the build change now is that you're no longer you're finally not just thinking about passives and talents, you're thinking about passive talents, you know, and itemization and set bonuses and things of that nature and affixes. You're thinking about a lot of different stuff when you're thinking about how you play your character, which is really cool.
Absolutely. The biggest win for itemization is items that change your build.
I think I definitely agree with that. I think that with Reaper of Souls, we're seeing a lot more options. Like, you find an item and go, wow, what could I do with that? Especially someone like me, where I like to be on the more mathematical side of things. I like to look at and go, okay, this is a cool idea. What if I did this, 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 and this, and put it with that item? Could it be overpowered, or could it be, you know, at least really good? And that's what I kind of do with that. And speaking of classes that need a little bit of adjustment in Diablo III, I want to talk more about the Demon Hunter now. Where in Diablo III, in the beginning of Diablo III, the very beginning, the Demon Hunter was probably one of the best classes in the game because it could efficiently get through Infernal difficulty. It had the burst damage. It could kite things around. The way the game was tuned. And then it started, as we came out with MP levels, a lot of the abilities that the Demon Hunter has, like the multi-shot or elemental arrow, are not quite as viable for higher difficulties. And it seems like in Reaper of Souls, the Demon Hunter is in a pretty good place right now. Are you afraid that it's going to get to that again, where the Demon Hunter is not going to be quite as good for solo farming and kind of being pushed into the group play?
Oh, wow. Okay, so this is a big topic.
Yeah, answer that quickly, please.
Yeah, Demon Hunters are awesome. Done. I love Demon Hunters.
I think the basic combat changes make a huge difference, because you feel so squishy in D3 now, and you're much less squishy now just because you don't get one-shotted.
Yeah, so survivability is the first thing I would talk about. In vanilla, the game can very often one-shot you, sometimes two-shot if your gear is good. We've tried to change that, and I think we've succeeded. Wyatt talks about that a lot, time to death and things. We shoot for a time to death of about 10 seconds if you're playing at a difficulty level appropriate for your gear.
Okay.
And that's a very big difference from vanilla, where you die in 1 second, 1.5 seconds. Because of that, things like dodge are more useful. I'm not saying dodge is amazing. I know dodge has its problems. Lots of problems, but that helps a lot. And the Demon Hunter as a class, classes are all designed differently. Demon Hunter is a ranged class.
Got the same layout two levels in a row with the same pool of reflection in the same place.
Yeah, Demon Hunters are designed differently from barbs, you know. They come into battle with full resource, so they can unload a bunch of damage. And that's kind of one of the big reasons why Demon Hunters are great at low MPs, because if I can empty my Hatred Bar before you touch me, I really don't need any survivability. Exactly. But as soon as I hit MP10 or Torment 6 or whatever, and things take a lot
then
longer,
it changes. Yeah, exactly.
Then I suddenly enter a flat mode where I both have to generate and spend, and then it becomes a real fight.
So as far as efficiency, do you think the Demon Hunter is going to be able to keep up with the rest of the classes as far as solo efficiency on higher difficulties as we progress towards Torment 6, which I'm sure everyone's going to be farming eventually? Do you think, like, and would you even consider maybe even increasing some of the abilities that are usually only used on lower difficulties, like I said, Elemental Arrow and Multi-Shot, you know, something like along those lines, or
I think the reason you mentioned Elemental Arrow and Multi-Shot are because you're probably talking about Ball Lightning, which hits a lot of things, and Multi-Shot, which also hits, you know, more than a second screen.
It's for the efficient, you know, getting through a big pack of monsters quickly, being efficient. You know, that's how I do all my builds. It has to be efficient or I'm not going to use it, and if the Demon Hunter is not efficient, I'm not going to use it, you know. So and I love the Demon Hunter, and I want to use it. So I just don't want to make sure that happens again in Reaper of Souls, you know?
Yeah, I think one answer is you need different skills for different difficulty levels. If you're playing at MP0, you're going to want an AoE generator and a big AoE spender. If you're playing at MP10, you're going to want, you know, more single-target things that do maybe slower damage over time, like Bola Shot gets
Echoing
a bonus
blast,
to damage because it's slow and has a delay. But it's not a problem if the monster is going to live for 60 seconds or a minute or whatever. Also, you may even want to think about taking something like Pale or Single Out passive to really help your DPS against that single target.
So what I'm getting from this is that you would that you guys are okay with the fact that some abilities are just not used at higher difficulties because you want people using other abilities instead of just using one spec the entire time. Just kind of more diversity, I guess. Is that kind of the way you're pushing it?
No, I think... Well, kind of. I think it's great that you can use different builds to succeed in different difficulties. As long as you have the tools to survive, to succeed, both survive and kill things, it's actually good if you have to switch your spec out. You know, if I go MP10, Ubers, I'm going to pick up Impale, Rapid Fire, the single target skills, Strafe, whatever. If I go MP0 farming, I'm going to get Ball Lightning. It's the way it goes, and that's not a bad thing. I'd be more concerned if it was shown that Demon Hunters could not succeed because their survivability is just too low. Or damage is just too low. But I think in the Reaper's world, skills should be very well tuned to all be generally viable.
And I do want to say one thing. Thank you for bringing back Smokescreen. We were using it in the beginning of Diablo 3. We stopped using it because Shadow Power is just the way to go. And the fact that we now have Healing Vapors, which heals us, I think is a really great addition. So good job there.
You play softcore, I'm guessing, right?
I play both.
Because Smokescreen never went away in hardcore Demon Hunters.
I play mostly softcore. I have a Paragon 100 Demon Hunter.
I don't play Demon Hunter in hardcore because it's probably the worst class in hardcore.
I would
seriously.
My character died, so I don't play hardcore.
I have
a level 60 hardcore of both classes, but not seriously.
When I last interviewed Wyatt, I pitched the whole why doesn't the Demon Hunter have a death cheating passive? You know, like the way the monk and the witch doctor and the wizard do. And obviously, it could be something just you get below 10% health, Smokescreen casts automatically. Which I noticed
totally
you actually put on
that.
One of the sets now.
Yeah, I actually really like that idea. I considered a cheat death passive as one of the three new passives of the Demon Hunter. But I'd say the Demon Hunter, maybe in addition to the Monk, has the best survivability buttons. You know, Smokescreen, Vault, Shadow Power are all pretty powerful. So I didn't feel the need, but I think it's totally an option for the future.
It's just, obviously it's a hardcore-only thing, pretty much, so.
Yeah, and
I think I think I've done 6 hardcore Demon Hunters, and bad things eventually happen.
I'm not opposed at all.
Speaking of hardcore, and also we're done with this rift, by the way.
There's still monsters here, we're not done? Oh, wait.
speaking of hardcore, I recently found some shoulders. I can't remember the name of them because I just found them last night on stream, which will make it so that you can't be interrupted while teleporting out, and you also get damage that's done to you is reduced by 64% while doing this. Do you feel like that type of item... You feel like that item is going to be too powerful and hardcore, and it's going to be the go-to shoulders because they're just like, oh, I'm about to die, teleport, bye.
Five seconds is a long time to be about to die.
Yeah.
Well, true, but...
There is a risk because if you think, I'm going to survive the next 5 seconds, let me cast this, get 50% damage reduction, maybe 2 seconds into the cast, you're at 1 HP, so then what do you do?
And you can't cast skills or else it resets, so...
Right, so at that point, there's some risk and reward. I think it's a fairly balanced item.
Let's do a new rift, all right, while we're all here in this corner.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I thought it was a fairly balanced item as well, because I've used it extensively in the closed beta so far in the friends and family, and what I found was that if you're actually going to die, you're still going to die. And what I found is that, for the most part, it's really a convenience item. Gives you a little bit of extra leeway, but overall, it's not really game-changing.
Well, it's awesome if you're, how often do you, while you teleport, are you town portaling back, and then, some bat hits you with 1 second left on the counter, and you're like, ah!
Yeah. That's the part
it's
I really
nice
like
just
about.
To avoid that. Have you ever tried to portal out of the surface area in Act 3 now, right after the bridge, where there's, never not a new bat flying down now in Reaper of Souls? It's you almost can't leave that area. It's like, please stop with the birds for 2 seconds. So, that's the Bartertown Pads area, I think. I just found a green hat here. Let's see what it was. Exciting.
Speaking more about the Demon Hunter, I talked about early in the beta how the companions seemed a little overpowered to the point that they could tank a Rift boss for you, a Rift Guardian for you. Mm. And if it was a melee Rift Guardian with no extra special abilities like some of them do, like they don't really just slam really hard or they hit really hard or something like that, for instance, what is your guys' feelings on the companion? Do you want the companion to act kind of like a follower where sometimes it takes damage, sometimes it doesn't, or the fact that it can just literally tank a Rift Guardian for me?
One companion tanking a Rift Guardian forever and not dying is probably a little overpowered. If it dies, it has, you know, 5 to 10 seconds of downtime. I don't remember the exact number. I think it's 5 seconds right now. Mm-hmm. That number might need to go up. Its survivability may need to go down. That's more of a fine-tuning thing. I have heard that companions, when you have like legendary that gives you 3 wolves, is a little overpowered. But I think that's fine. And it also comes down to the AI of the specific mob. I know some bosses in Reaper of Souls are specifically set to ignore pets, but okay. some of the vanilla bosses don't have that set, so they may be a little too easy. We may revisit that in the future, the vanilla bosses, because mm-hmm. we don't want pets to, you know, just make it too easy.
True.
Sure. And obviously they scale up with your damage, but if you have that high a damage, you're not going to have problems with vanilla bosses anyway.
They also scale up with your survivability, though, too. Yeah. If you have a lot of health, a lot of survivability, they're going to be tanky, you know?
Yeah.
So.
But I wouldn't want to put them down too much either, because as pets go in Diablo III in general, it's a fairly underwhelming and underrepresented area of potential gameplay, in my opinion.
They were practically useless in Diablo 3. I mean, and now though, I like that they're better. I would have liked to see some new graphics or something like that on the companions, maybe a best looking boar or something like that, or the wolf to be bigger and more ferocious, demon like or something. You know what I'm saying? Like, but I guess that's not on your end, you know. So,
it's got green eyes.
It's a priority thing. I don't think they're so bad to be more important than making other things in the game. So
mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I don't mean actually the Demon Hunter pets themselves. I actually think those are pretty rocking. Quite like those. But I just think in general as a game it doesn't have, you know, a particular pet focus, let's say, like maybe a Necro was in D2, but or like some other, you know, games have. But overall I think there's a lot of stuff that's done really, really well. But that's just one area that I hope gets revisited in the future.
Yeah, I mean, just look at the companion changes. We spent a significant amount of design and programming time to get that done.
And I really like those. And, you know, honestly, John, the reason I like the changes to the companion system is because now I actually have to think through which companion do I want to use. It's not an easy, obvious choice. It's actually something you got to think about.
Definitely. That goes along with the whole making sure all skills are balanced against each other. Because then you have a real choice depending on gear and playstyle. Difficult.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really interesting. Yeah, I would bet in vanilla, 90% of players who use companion use back companion. Because it was
definitely
a little too good and everything else was a little not good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So yeah, these days I try a bunch of different ones.
I have a question getting to more, I guess, little more broad questions here. The gold that you currently get in Reaper of Souls, I'm sure you've heard this before, it is not enough. A lot of players are worried that they're not going to bring enough gold into the game. Are you planning on increasing the amount of gold that we get for bounties and such, or for rifts, or just for collecting in general? Or do you feel like it's currently where it needs to be?
I don't know what our target number for number and chance we want to give you per hour played or things like that are, but we do have a number. This is something Wyatt and Andrew worked on, tuning gold to us, so I'm not the best person to ask about that, but it's definitely mm-hmm. on radar, and it's something that's easy to hotfix and tune if you feel it's not good enough. It's being watched, but I don't really have any information aside from that.
Related mm-hmm. issue just is on the enchanting costs. You just changed it so legendary rings require a flawless imperial and amulets, and there's no more gold cost on those. I actually like that change. I read an article about that a couple of days ago. People were debating it, but it seems like the bottleneck is now meant to be gems. You need 9 marquee gems to enchant those instead of just whatever gold you have lying around.
Oh yeah, having different costs for things is good. It gives you an option. You know, if I have, for some reason, way too many gems, I can enchant rings and amulets instead of something else.
Well, we have way too many gems after 2 months of beta and just stacking them up, but I can see at launch when you need 9 marquee every time you want to make this enchant, because you're not going to have 500 of them built up, so...
That might be a tuning issue. I guess I'll keep an eye out for that, or ask Andrew to.
I think it's a good change. I mean, it's just a different bottleneck. I assume that was part of you guys' general urge to make gold less essential and less valuable, so people who bring over 10 billion from Diablo 3 will not have a huge advantage.
Well, people who come over from Diablo 3 with a bunch of gold, our gold sink for them is increasing costs on enchanting a single item. So hopefully that works.
Those have gone down steadily over the beta. I mean, it was like 2 million for an amulet at the start of the beta. And now it's like 40K.
Yeah, well, I don't mean that. I don't mean increasing over time in the beta patch cycle. I mean, if I enchant this item once, it costs X, and the next time it costs X plus more, and then more, and then more. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But speaking of the Mystic, though, I did have a question. Right now in the game, if you want to switch out an item, you can see what it's going to do for you, benefit you wise. You can say, this is going to give me more damage, this is going to give me more health or toughness and stuff like that. But when you're doing the Mystic, you go, well, should I get attack speed or should I get crit chance or should I get average damage or should I get attack speed? You can't see what kind of benefit you would get. And you just kind of have to hope, is this an upgrade when you're doing the Mystic and enchanting? Is that something you guys are going to maybe give us a feature so that we can... be able to see that kind of change so we don't have to risk the gold and, risk the materials?
That's definitely a possibility. I wouldn't consider that a high feature because it's programming time. It's probably some UI time. But I think that's not unreasonable. That sounds like something that would be useful.
Yeah, exactly.
Just a green-red preview kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sounds useful.
Just gonna be like, this will give you a little upgrade, and you're like, oh, nice, I'll re-roll to this, and it helps you out, so.
Well, it reminds you of the early days of the auction house, where there was no comparison, and you just had to kind of guess. It's like, is this better?
I had spreadsheets. I would type in all of the stuff, and I would be like, okay, this is an upgrade, this isn't an upgrade, and stuff like that, until you guys actually just did it for me, so.
Oh yeah.
That's what I had to do.
I had spreadsheets, I had websites.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, John, so this zip code, I got a question for you on itemization.
Sure, go for it.
If you don't mind. I wouldn't say it's a complaint, but one of the observations I've heard sort of stated in previous interviews with devs, and I'd be interested in your perspective, given you do at Blizzard, would be the progression of the items that you get as a player. So you play your Demon Hunter, you play your Barbarian or whatever, and as the game progresses, you find items, and every so often, there's timers and all the rest of it. How happy are you with where things are in terms of the way in which an average player, not a casual, not a hardcore, but an average player, progresses through the item finding experience, how they go from being a fairly, relatively speaking, Nephilim, all the way through to being a, Torment 6 face roll Nephilim. How do you feel that is playing out right now in terms of starting out basic items, going to yellow items, getting legendaries, and completing sets?
It's a big question.
Yeah,
I know.
I think, progression is obviously the main part of this game, the item progression specifically.
Yeah.
It's going to happen at a certain rate, and we can tune that through legendary drop rates. And I feel like it's pretty good. Obviously, the faster we drop items, the more quickly you're going to find them, and the more quickly you're going to run out of upgrades to find. And the time to the next upgrade is also going to increase, because when an item drops, there's less chance that it's a good item for you, or better than what you currently have. So there's a number between 0 and 100 on that scale that we can drag around to say players, it's going to take player 1 hour to find the next upgrade after they played for X hours. And that's a number we've been tuning, and it's purely based on a legendary drop rate. And I think it's pretty good right now. There's lots of legendaries out there. I'm sure we'll be adding more in the future. Sets, the rare items. There's always things to chase. I haven't really heard any complaints about... I haven't...
You've heard complaints. There's always complaints.
I've heard complaints about everything. There will be complaints about everything. I don't think it's a problem right now, and I feel like I really like the place where it's at.
Yeah.
We'll see after I play for 500 hours if I think differently. But based on our numbers and our calculations, you should be able to play this game for a long time and not have all the best items you want for, you know, the best set items and things like that.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, a big part of what keeps a player playing is the concept of gaining equity, right? So you're gaining equity as a player in the game. And I think that in Diablo 3, the way you do that is through gaining items that give you either different ways to play the game or different levels of power. So I definitely think you're right. There has to be a balance there that keeps that chase going while at the same time gives you that feeling of equity and development, you know? So.
Yeah, we talked about this a lot during our discussions on legendary items. We had weekly meetings for months with all the people who were relevant. And we thought about, you know, are there ways which you can design the drop system where the time until the next upgrade stays constant for the rest of the time? And that's a hard problem to solve. And I think unless we did some really hacky ways to make that work, I mean, there are hacky ways to make that work. Like, you require 100,000 damage to find this item, and you require 150,000 to find the next item. But that doesn't feel like Diablo, and it's just a little too messy to feel right. So we didn't do something like that.
I don't like that concept personally. I don't like a definitive fixed static, you know, progression rate. I think that's unwelcome because it takes away from the feeling of randomness, which in the right amount adds a ton of value to the gameplay.
Absolutely.
It's really important.
Obviously, that would put a huge priority on DPS too, much, you know, hardcore players who want to go more defensive.
And we definitely want players to have the feeling that at any moment I could find the best item in the game for all the time.
Even as long as you're on torment.
Right. That's a different problem, and I think it's fine. At torment one is.
And speaking of legendaries, as we're talking about them right now, as you've noticed, and as many people have noticed in the game, there are a lot of legendaries that don't have special properties, and also the crafting legendaries seem to be very lacking. Are we going to see anything in the future that is going to maybe bring us new legendaries, maybe even by launch, or maybe in a patch before launch on beta? Or are we just like, this is what you see is what you get right now?
Oh, by launch, that's out of scope. That's really not going to happen. In the future, you know, content patches and stuff, we will definitely be adding more legendaries.
Mm-hmm.
And the legendaries without powers, that was really just a production type thing. I made many of the legendary powers myself, along with lots of help from our programmers and stuff. It's just a matter of how much we can do, given the time we have.
Yeah. Well, the reason why I bring it up is because Josh Mascara actually talked about in an interview that and also at BlizzCon that when you get a legendary, you want it to make it feel like it is a legendary moment, like, oh my God, this is it, like this is the item, you know, like I've been farming all night long and I want to be rewarded here, like, you know, as you're kind of talking about a little bit earlier. But that's why I bring up that point, is because, you know, if more items had more special properties, or even if a pattern dropped and you said, oh, okay, I can make this item, but I'm not going to because it's going to be crappy. You know, it's like, for instance, there's actually an item in my stash right now. I found a crossbow last night that the max damage that it can roll on it is equal to what the max damage of one hand legendary can roll on it. And that seems not correct at all, you know? Like, it seems like the crafted items are a little lower than they should be.
Crafted items should roll in the same ranges as legendaries, if that crafted item's a legendary. I'd have to ask you to repeat that again, but the way you put it, it sounds like a bug.
But I can show you, when we go back to town, I'll show you the item itself, but
Given two legendary items, if they're both level 70 and one is crafted and one is dropped, they should have the same max damage roll. They should have the same max roll for everything, if they're the same slot. crafted items are not meant to be worse. And if they are, that's a bug.
Mm-hmm. A few of the weapons now I notice have like 15% cold or fire damage as an inherent. They're not all just, you know, six random stats anymore. So it seems like you guys are getting a little bit of the, you know, giving them some flavor and some variety now.
Oh, absolutely.
It just takes time to get it all done.
Yeah, it really depends on if it makes sense, you know. I think there's a, it's like a frost orb that has a legendary power that does something with frozen frost nova. And it makes sense, so we put cold damage on it, and if it looks like an arcane item, we put some arcane damage on it. When it makes sense thematically, we try very hard to make the item fit the theme of the item and the lore and what it looks like and everything. But, you know, some of the items that are more generic looking, it doesn't always work. But we've definitely had some big wins there when it does match.
On crafting cost, currently some of the sets require a flawless royal diamond, which is about 10 million to make. Is that going to stay that way? Or it seems really arbitrary, like some of the Kane's items do and a few others, but then lots of stuff doesn't require any gem at all, and it's like a really wild price differential.
Yeah, gems were put, as we mentioned earlier, Andrew put them there as a replacement for the gold cost. I would bet the ones that take a gem don't cost gold. Because, well, they shouldn't. Because
yeah, but I mean, even if it does, that's 10 million gold for that gem versus, you know,
yeah,
like 100k or something. So
that that really might be a tuning point and a tuning problem. Yeah, that's about all.
But at the same time, that wouldn't be as much of a problem if we had more viable ways of making gold in the game. You would be like, 10 million, no big deal. If you're making, you know, 30 million per hour or something like that, right? So
well, we don't want to give players so much gold that it becomes irrelevant, because I think the important question is the ratio of the cost to make that gem to the cost to craft an item that doesn't cost a gem, the gold cost. If that ratio is more in line with each other, I think we're good, and then we can tune gold drop rates around that. At the current levels, it sounds like the items that cost gold to enchant, sorry, cost gems to enchant or craft are a little out of line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, related on legendary materials, though, that's also a really variable thing. I mean, some of them I have like 10 and 12, and other ones I've never seen once. And it seems like if that was correlated with, you know, the scarcity was correlated with the value, it would make more sense. But as it is, it's just sort of arbitrary, it seems like. I guess it's just more tuning passes needed.
I have a theory on that, but I wasn't involved in any of the crafting stuff. Andrew kind of solos that. I don't think any of the crafting materials have lower drop rates. They might. I could be just making stuff up, but...
Well, frequency of where... I mean, I'm looking at my stash now. I have 13, 11, and 9 of three of them, and then a bunch of the other ones I just have one of each.
Yeah, I think it's a more of where you end up playing because of the bounties and stuff. If you happen to see the dude, you kill him, you get the thing, and then you end up with a lot more of them. And maybe the uniques that are harder to find or the ones you don't encounter in normal play, you have less of them.
Yeah.
So that can also be, that could maybe be changed via placement of a monster, but I don't know if tuning the drop rate would be the right answer, because then you could always farm it, right? You know, if you really wanted this item, you could farm him, find him specifically. So maybe changing the drop rates isn't the right answer.
I think I like variable drop rates. I just think that if there's going to be ones that are really rarely found, that should be the ones that have on the most powerful potential items. And
totally
currently, there doesn't seem like there's any correlation between it now.
Totally agree with rarity equals power. I do not know what the rarity is on those, or the power level of a lot of the crafted items.
The items that actually linked in the chat right there, you can see that the one hand Odin's Son, if you look at the potential on it, it can go up to 1490 lightning damage, and if you look at the two hand that I just found, it can go up to 1490 poison damage there, and that's one way of increasing your damage on your weapon is by doing that. Is that a bug? Is that intended? Supposed to get higher?
I can't see the roll ranges in chat, really? Maybe
you can't. If you click on it and then just push like control while you're clicking, I think it might work. But
it work.
Only I can see it or something.
Oh, I have to hold down control and
you hold control then click,
Just drop the item and let him look at it. Oh wait.
Oh, you got it now. Yeah,
if no, the roll range is, I said before.
If the roll range is wrong, it's a bug. If it's not, it's not a bug. It looks like the lightning and poison damage max rolls are the same to me. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, and one of them's a two-hander and one of them's a one-hander. So.
That sounds like a bug.
Yeah.
We have different affixes for one-handers and two-handers, and maybe one of them has the wrong one. It's very possible.
Okay. Well, that's good that you're at least looking into those things and such. So, you know, makes me feel better that two-handers would be more viable. As you know, with the Demon Hunter, one advantage the Demon Hunter has had is the fact that we have a crossbow or a bow, and then we also have a quiver, whereas the Barbarian classes like that only have just the two-hander. So, you know, it seemed more viable for a Demon Hunter to use a two-hander over dual-wielding. Do you think that dual wielding is going to be more viable for the Demon Hunter in Reaper of Souls, or is two hands still going to be the way to go?
The problem is very different for the Barbarian Demon Hunter because of the quiver. Barbarians can't use a two hand in the main hand and, you know, a one hander in the off hand or something like that. For the Demon Hunter, it's a problem that the quivers are so good, specifically Dead Man's Legacy. Also, specifically, that it was easily buyable in the auction house. Disregarding that, I think quivers are still really powerful. They give 20% attack speed and all these stats. So it's really kind of stupid to take a one-hander and a quiver in Vanilla Land. In expansion, I took some steps to try to close the gap between the two playstyles. One of them is for ranged weapons only, bows. We reduce the gap in damage between one-handers and two-handers, so two-hand crossbows and one-hand crossbows. Very specifically, because Demon Hunters can use quivers. We're not planning to change that, so we just tune around it. Also, you know, for things like archery, there was a bonus for one-hand crossbow, but there wasn't for second one, so I just added a bonus. The bonus may not be enough, we'll see. But as other people have said, I think what's really going to drive people to use one weapon over the other is ultimately the legendary power. I think there are compelling enough legendaries that are one-hander and two-hander that you just use whatever you find. And I think that's okay. But once you find everything, I think they should be viable compared to each other. And those are numbers we can continuously look at. I think it's okay. One dual one-hander is still not great, but not terrible. Mm-hmm.
Well, in theory, you get the benefit of the huge critical hit damage if you go with two weapons. Obviously, you can't get that on a quiver. But there's so much AS on quivers and so many other stats. I have two other questions on quivers while we're on the topic. You realize there's no white quivers right now, so you can't craft them? There are no white off-handed items. You can't get orbs or mojos either.
Oh, sounds like a bug.
They just don't drop anywhere. So there's no way to make crafted of those items currently.
I'll follow up on that afterwards. Make sure that gets looked at and fixed.
The other issue on quivers is there is a spectacular amount of mods because essentially every single skill plus lots of other stuff. And if you don't roll one with CD, with a critical hit chance, when it rolls, it's just almost impossible to enchant to it, especially on a legendary.
Yeah.
I think I found four legendary quivers so far in ROS. None of them have had critical hit chance, so therefore none of them are really very viable.
Yeah, crit chance remains a problem. Crit chance and crit damage remains a problem. Gems are a problem. We thought about doing different things to actively combat the problem, but we've instead of doing something drastic and very punishing like a cap, we decided to just, you know, remove critical hit damage from rolling on weapons. I think crit chances and also doesn't roll on weapons except for, I think, a couple legendaries.
Yeah.
We decided to give you less because they benefit from each other and scale with each other. They're really good. That's kind of a whole different topic. No great solutions right now. It remains a good stat.
I'm just wondering about specifically on quivers, because if you don't get it on the quiver, you know, it's just so hard to enchant it compared to almost any other item in the game that doesn't have that many potential mods. It seems like the legendary quiver should have like at least like a 5 to 10% roll guaranteed, so at least you'd have a chance to use it.
Well, why do you say a crit chance on a quiver is more necessary than crit chance on an amulet or something?
I guess
the amulet can roll skill damage or something.
Well, it's really nice on the amulet, too. I mean, amulets and rings and gloves are obviously the hardest things to enchant. But just, I mean, if you look, go to the enchantress and look at the quiver, and there's, cause, I mean, there's like 32 options if you try to reroll it. And whereas most offhand items, there's, you know, 8 or 10 or 12.
Yeah, I guess what you talked about is overloading of a certain item slot, and that's something we did on purpose because, you know, on live, amulets, you need to have trifecta, rings, gloves, you gotta have trifecta, or mm-hmm. they suck. And rather than, say, preventing an item, like an amulet, from rolling one or more of the trifectas, and then, you know, making level 60 items with trifecta being a problem, maybe you wanna keep them. We decided to just overload the slot with many more awesome affixes like CDR or crit, not crit, skill damage on amulet that would make it competitive. So then when you roll any of those, any combination of those, then you have a pretty good item. Rather than say if you don't have the trifecta, you have a shitty item.
Yeah, the as it was in the past, if you said crit chance, trifecta, and such are very important, but now you've implemented something like elemental damage, which is also going to be something very viable. You may be like, well, you know, I don't have trifecta, but I do have 20% increase of fire damage, and I'm using a fire ability and such. So those things do bring up for, you know, more effective DPS. That's what it seems like Reaper of Souls is all about, is the effective DPS and not the paper DPS, right?
Well, it's not like we said effective DPS is more important than Reaper. What we ended up designing are affixes that don't show up in your damage calculation because they're not always applicable. So things like CDR, resource cost reduction, plus elemental damage, plus damage to skills. And those are things that I do want to add to the details page. I have some plans for that. But aside from that, there are things that we don't put into damage, so they just don't show up. And it wasn't because we didn't want things to show up in damage, it's just how the affixes ended up being designed.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking of something very interesting talking about that discussion, and with the new elemental stuff that is out, some classes actually benefit much more with the elemental stuff, like the wizard, whereas they have things like spectral blades with flame blades, which increases fire damage, and that's a skill that increases fire damage, whereas other classes are pretty much lacking in those areas, where if you want to go with an elemental build, and which seems like a very viable way to do a lot of damage, it looks like wizards are going to be the best at that. I mean, as they should be, but what are you doing to balance that to make sure that all classes can equally put out balanced damage so that doesn't get too crazy, you know?
Yeah, what happened in development was the wizards were worked on first, just, you know, we picked a class to work on first, for the artists to work on first. And when the artists were working on the wizard, we decided to do all this elemental stuff as part of the wizard's kit, because they're really the most elemental class to begin with.
Yeah.
And that was one of the three core concepts behind the wizard in the first place. And the artists spent, you know, a lot of time working on it, and then they got busy, so they didn't have as much time to work on the other classes. But we never had plans to do all this elemental stuff in the first place. We thought up elemental damage as an item affix kind of late because elemental damage didn't work out as originally designed. Do you remember the design where lightning... Oh, wait. I don't know if this design was ever on beta, but this design where
all
lightning
the secondary
causes...
effects.
Yeah,
lightning hurts when stunned and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, and fire does a burning, you know, crushing blow type damage. Yeah, that didn't work out for different reasons, but because of that, we decided to pursue elemental damage in the skill direction and make them into item affixes, which worked out really well. So we said, hey, we've got these item affixes we want to do. Let's make sure the classes have this elemental stuff. The wizard already had lots because it was designed into her skills. Oh, I'm DC from the game, I think.
Oh, no.
Oh, no, I'm good.
Oh, you're still here.
It was designed into her kit, and it was artified, so it was already working. So then we had to kind of, you know, do some lot of work later on, thank you artists, to put elemental damage on a lot of the other classes, especially the ones who are more, like, melee-focused. Like, Barbarian is was pretty much all physical, everything, every day,
all day.
We kind of did some last minute stuff to make that work.
That's actually quite recent.
Yeah, just the last patch, like half the skills. Half the skill rune effects. Like, this is now lightning, this is now poison, this is now whatever.
If you see Julian at our next BlizzCon, you can thank him for it. Julian, our lead tech artist.
Julian Love?
Yeah, Julian Love. Wow, you know name. I didn't want to give last names, I didn't know if it was cool, but there it is, Julian Love.
I've actually known him since the Diablo 2 days. I saw him at BlizzCon a couple years ago. He's like, oh, Flux, what's up? I haven't seen you in 8 years. I'm like, okay.
That's awesome. Yeah, he plays a lot of Diablo 2. He shows me Diablo 2 stuff once in a while. Continue on the elemental discussion. We have plans to add a lot more elemental stuff to all the classes, probably except the wizard, who already has enough.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking actually of a cool idea, just kind of throwing it out there. I don't know what your guys' plans are, but you know how we had talent trees in Diablo 2, maybe have elemental trees, which could make your, you know, could change things. You could have elemental stuff that does more damage or maybe summons elemental pets or whatever. I mean, I know this is such a huge change and would probably never come for a long time, but would that be something you would think about?
That's probably outside of the scope of something.
Yeah, next patch. Just throw that in there.
Next patch.
You got a month till launch. You can do it.
Yeah, let's make it happen.
Yeah.
Hey, John, this is Sipko. One more itemization question for you. Try and make it a little narrower in scope. Yeah, maybe a couple combined. We'll see how things progress here. What's your feeling, you know, around the concept of finding items randomly in the world, as opposed to having specific, say, boss or Rift Guardian loot tables that can drop items that even it's not a guarantee, you know, you're not going to kill this monster and guaranteed an item, but similarly to how it's been done in the past with loot tables versus, you know, say, like, right now the game is heading toward crafting items that drop off specific monsters. What's the thought of having random legendaries and random set items as opposed to giving players a way to control a little more deeply the way in which they farm for items?
We thought about that, definitely talked about that for a long time.
I bet.
There is a desire to let players be able to decide what item they can find. You know, sort of, I don't have a good weapon, I'm gonna farm these five bosses who have a good chance to draw a crossbow.
Exactly.
We didn't decide to do that because...
Why don't you think of that for a second? I'll tell you what I think about it, because the reason behind it, I think one of the things that Kadala tried to do was give players a little bit more control over legendaries, and that became very hard to balance. And I think there's a lot of things like that. I think the rift bag, you know, potential drops that are specific to those rift acts, I mean, those bounty bags that are specific to various acts are a good way of doing it as well, right? So that's something that's additional. And I think having the ability to go after a specific monster to complete a set would be a really cool concept as well. It gives players a little bit of control.
Oh, yeah. Real quick, Kadala is one area where you can try to kind of target find, and it is, you know, you probably spent all your blood shards on the weapon if you didn't have a good weapon. For completing sets, it is a potential problem that when I have 3 out of 4 pieces of my set, or 5 out of 6 or whatever, the last piece is incredibly hard to find, and it takes a really long time to find the last item. That's why we made the Ring of Royal Grandeur. It's like a stopgap item to help you complete your set. And then when you finally complete your set, you can take that item off and put something else on in its place.
Yeah, I think those are good measures, and I like them. I think they're definitely the right direction, as well as the bounty bag. I think that's really cool as well. I still think it would have been really cool. And I love, by the way, the crafting materials are specifically dropping off types of monsters. Definitely worth looking at again, in my opinion, to consider having loot tables on, say, Rift Guardians. I would love to see that Rift Guardians could drop something, or a boss in particular, whether it be, you know, Belial or something
that's
else.
That's a potential idea for the future. Yeah.
You guys actually talked about that earlier on. You said you were thinking about doing that, but you didn't want players to only farm those things, kind of like in Diablo 2, and then let's go, you know, farm this or farm that, you know, farm a certain boss. So maybe that's another thing that's kind of holding you back on that. You want players out into the world and doing bounties and doing rifts and such.
Yeah, the problem of flipping games to do the same thing over and over, it's fun for a time, but if you don't get what you want after a certain number of runs, you get really annoyed that this is all you can do. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of a design problem with it. Real quick, I'm being told I have 5 minutes left. Maybe just a... I think we start a little late, so, you know, 5 minutes, yeah. A couple more questions, maybe two.
Can I ask one more question, and then maybe can we take a couple of viewer questions? We got 962 people in here that have been begging to get their questions answered.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, so for me, I personally really enjoy this game. I've been playing the beta since I got into it. I want to keep playing it for a long period of time. What kind of progressions are you guys making towards making us have longevity behind the game instead of just doing bounties, just doing rifts? As fun as they are, eventually it's going to get old, you know? Is there going to be additional things other than Ubers in the future that you can maybe talk about or give some kind of hint towards? That kind of keep players like, oh, I'm going to buy Diablo right now, you know, like get them hyped.
Yeah, the problem with, you know, telling people what they might get in a future patch early is if things don't work out for whatever reason, then people will call you and get mad about it. Mm-hmm. It's definitely not designer's position to talk about future things, but mm-hmm. we have ideas, solid ideas in place that I think will help progression in the future. Mm-hmm. You'll probably see them.
And real quick here, the because I had a lot of questions here, but I mean, I got most of them answered, which is great. I just want to end with the Paragon portraits. Are we going to be getting more portraits in the future? And also, when you get to Paragon 800, you're no longer getting stats anymore. So is there going to be something, is the cap going to be raised from 50 on each one of those? Or... so that players that took the time to get to Paragon 801 actually go, wow, I'm here, but I don't get anything, you know?
I just went to core.
Yeah, after you max out on everything, all your points go to the core stat, the core page.
So just main stat, basically.
Yeah, yeah. And the portraits, I'm not sure about the portraits. Sounds like a good idea, though.
Yeah. All right, so guys, if you want to ask some questions, he doesn't have very much longer. I know a lot of people are asking about the Imperious Wings. They have talked about that before.
Yeah,
I'm
they
sure
said don't ask about
he's
it.
Not gonna, yeah, I'm sure he's not going to have a comment on that. And same goes for ladders and PvP as well, too. So if you guys have some questions you want to ask real quick, we are kind of strapped for time here, and he's been nice enough to lend his time to us. So what are some questions you guys have? I see one right here. Ask about the clan cap. This is coming from Azuris. Is there a reason why it's capped at 150, or is that going to be raised in the future? Or
I was not involved in the clan's design, but the idea behind having a cap at all is if there are so many people in a clan, like say 500, that you know, whoever everybody joins, I don't know who's in the clan, I don't know these people, it starts to feel more like a community and less like a clan. That's the basic idea. I really can't get into any specifics behind that. I wasn't involved in it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I have an easy item question for you on my list. Yeah, socketing benefits are wildly especially for witch doctors and wizards. I mean, you're pretty much guaranteed to have like 700 res all from your main stat. You know, you have 7,000 res at high level,
right.
And you're putting you're putting 280 in a socket. That also gives you 28 res all, which is really beneficial. So I mean, you compare like a wizard to a demon hunter. The wizard's going to have guaranteed like 700 more res all, and whereas mm-hmm. the demon hunter has dodge, which no one likes anyway.
Oh, okay. So that ties into like the big problem of the three stats. You know, a demon hunter gets 100 dex, strength classes get 100 strength, int classes get 100 int.
And int and strength are better than dex in the secondary benefits.
Yeah, I think I looked at the numbers earlier today. I think the amount of survivability that dex provides is about 15 to 20% lower than the amount that int and strength provides. You can do this. You test yourselves. Just put yourself at 5,000 armor, 5,000 int, and just compare all those stats like that. That's about 15 to 20% off. I think I want to look at maybe tuning the dodge formula a bit, or giving the demon hunter specifically other ways to benefit from dodge. Dodge is a problem in and of itself, because you know a lot of EHP peers, I'm kind of one of them, wouldn't consider dodge a real survivability stat because it's random, and you know your number of hits to death is not great with dodge. On an infinite scale, dodge is great. It works advertise, but you know, given the 10-second death timer, dodge is not super reliable. That said, I think Demon Hunter as a class is ranged and has many tools to survive burst damage and oh shit moments. And maybe has the most tools to survive oh shit moments, aside from a cheat death path, which I do want to add. Aside from that, dodge, the main complaint, one of the main complaints is dodge doesn't work on unavoidable damage. We've tried to make a lot of things dodgeable in a game when they make sense, like sand wasps. We recently changed sand wasps projectiles to also be dodgeable. They weren't in vanilla, but I think there can be more done, like poop on the ground, you still can't dodge, desecrator, plagued, etc. I was just talking to Joe, our monster designer today, about what we can do about that. He plays a Demon Hunter also, and I think a good idea is to add some kind of AoE damage reduction to a passive like awareness. I think that's what I want to do in a future patch, to add maybe 30% AoE damage reduction to that passive for Demon Hunters only. And then all the poop on the ground, you just take 30% less damage from.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. Especially because resistance is hard to get in a Demon Hunter.
Yeah, it's the problem in parody. When someone says armor and resist all works for Desecrator, but dodge doesn't, I really don't have a good answer, because there is none. So that's something I definitely want to do.
And the answer is not Blizzard hates Demon Hunters.
I have a Paragon 100 Demon Hunter. I love Demon Hunters. It's my main class. I plan to play it when it ships. Yeah, my favorite character in Diablo 2 was an Amazon. Had 98 Amazon and a 99 Sorceress. I plan to play Demon Hunter until the end of days. Also Barbarian. I love Barbarian too.
You love all the classes.
No, just those two. I have Paragon 100.
okay, so Blizzard hates monks then.
No.
You play an assassin too?
Don loves monks. You can talk to Don about monks tomorrow.
The big question, I think, to sum it up here, because we are running out of time here, a lot of people are asking about Loot 2.0. Can you get us any information? Is it going to be launching before the game comes out, or are we going to have to wait to the expansion?
Loot 2.0?
Yeah.
I think it's Diablo 3 version 2.
What's being tested on the PTR currently to be implemented before, maybe by when the auction house goes down, or maybe a little bit before?
Patch 2.01 is going to have Loot 2.0. And it will be out before Reaper ships. So that's about it. Sometime between today and March 25th.
Sweet. Good to know.
People always ask questions you can't answer. It's amazing. They're uncanny at that.
Yeah, PR is better. PR and community, they should be the ones publicizing big information like that. So really don't want to.
Yeah.
All right. I think that's all the time I had for today. It was great talking to you guys. I'd love to do this again.
Yeah, me too. I'd love to sit down and just chat with you even one-on-one or whatever. I mean, the fact that you did this, I want to thank you on behalf of myself and also the community here as well. We're all very happy that you could take the time to do this. I know you're very busy. You got a big launch coming up, and I wish you luck with everything you have to do. And once again, thank you for hanging out with us and answering some questions.
Thanks a lot, Shinobi, Sipco, Flux. It's great talking to you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Sean. Appreciate it.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. See you.
And now we sit here in awkward silence.